Shaping Their Lives on BBC One in a moment. For BBC Two in 50 minutes, genealogy for an Austin Healey frog eye sprite. Now, when that sprite first hit the road in 1960, traffic wasn't too big a headache, but today it's a major cause of intense irritation and frayed tempers. BBC Two begins a new series exploring the nightmare of getting from A to B.
It's the morning rush hour in Hammersmith Broadway, West London. As buses fight their way through the traffic, the need to get people out of their cars and onto public transport is clear. At the heart of the Broadway is Hammersmith Bus Station, one of the newest and biggest in Britain. Car use has increased fivefold over the last 40 years, while the number of Londoners using buses has declined. But now the government has decided that the Red London Bus is the vehicle to unlock the capital's gridlock. Recently, bus use has slightly increased, but if there's going to be a real revival, it'll have to start in places like Hammersmith, with conductors and drivers like Crooks and Clare.
What I'll do on the next bus, do you know that blind that's there? I'll lift it up so you can see. What? You'll see me dancing and all that.
Yeah, yeah.
Get me closer, I'm out of the sitting on that.
Claire's a bit of a nutcase, you know? She likes everything fast, you know? Fast and hard.
Buses. Don't matter which way you turn, they'll always get in your way.
She's a bit rough around the edges, like, you know what I mean? I think I'm going to have to be careful with the old people and stuff like that, you know what I mean? Let them sit down before I ring her off.
Traffic's heavy and Crooks and Clare have a tight schedule.
Oh, man, every set of traffic lights is red. Obviously waiting for me.
We're 10 minutes late. You understand what I mean? It's supposed to be in Hyde Park Corner at this very moment now.
Gone straight for the taxi.
Yeah. You have to be Nigel Mansell to stick to these times. Because they haven't changed the running times. They've given us, what, 1950s running times with 1990s traffic. Can't do it, can you?
1990s traffic is the result of decisions taken 40 years ago which had a profound effect on the way we travel today. Every journey involves an act of individual choice. Given that choice, we've decided not to travel by bus.
Upper Collins West 12.
Oh, it's on this lane, that's right. Yeah, no, we've been around here next
week. In 1960, traffic conditions at Hammersmith Broadway had so seriously worsened that only constant police supervision enabled vehicles to move at all. The number of vehicles using the Broadway in 1956 had been a little over 35,000 each day. But 4 years later, this figure had doubled to 70,000. In an attempt to solve this problem, traffic was fed into a system of one-way streets which converted the Broadway area into a large roundabout.
30 years ago, undoubtedly, the whole process and traffic management was geared up to help the car, and that was the top of the pecking order, really.
Indeed, we had things called passenger car units, where we assessed everything in terms of the car, and so that even a bus was the equivalent of three cars, and a cycle was the equivalent of a third of a car.
There was almost a degree of stigma attached to travelling in public transport, and the whole aim was to try and help cars.
Like many other town centres, Hammersmith was rebuilt to suit the needs of the car. Pedestrians were forced down into subways. Towering over it all was the mighty Hammersmith flyover.
This is the longest flyover of its type in Europe. And these slim, clean lines show just how a flyover ought to be built.
A new professional was created, the traffic engineer, and his task was clear.
We used every piece of road space available to move cars round. We moved them in queues. We moved them round corners. We made one-way streets. We had, quite honestly, little regard for the environment and the residential communities, but the traffic moved faster.
It cost £1,300,000, this last piece in the jigsaw designed to speed traffic flow to London Airport, to the west and the southwest. And each of the 70,000 motorists who daily battle through this Hammersmith bottleneck will say that it's money well spent.
Today, nearly 200,000 motorists pass through Hammersmith every day. For 40 years, ever greater capacity has been squeezed out of London's roads.
If you look at traffic speeds in London, they haven't changed dramatically over the last sort of 30, even 50 years, despite the increase in traffic.
It's a miracle of traffic management. All of the capital's signals are linked to a control room in Scotland Yard. 250 cameras monitor hold-ups, which can be cleared by adjusting the timing of traffic lights across the city. This system has created room for ever-increasing traffic, but now it's clear that the miracle has created a monster.
London's network is on a knife edge. There's no doubt about that. Gridlock's an emotive word, but it's not that far off that.
The prognosis is not a good one. The network is reaching the limits of its finite capacity.
We cannot accommodate the growth in cars any longer.
Given the choice between the bus and the car, we don't choose the bus. Typical is the Davis family, whose school run takes them through Hammersmith.
10 years ago, 80% of people walked their children to school. Now, 80% of people drive to school. Safety of the children is one of the prime issues. I wouldn't let my child walk to school. They want their children to arrive at school safely and get home safely, and no undertaking you can give to a parent, quite understandably. They want 100% certainty.
Few of us are under any illusion about the consequences of our addiction to the car, not even eight-year-old Guy.
When I get older, I'm thinking of having a job as trying to invent a new machine that won't pollute things like cars, or just have masses of taxis and buses on the roads and that's it. Because in about at least 1,000 years, if cars keep on going like this, the world will be really polluted. And lots of people will be dying just from walking around on the streets.
5 miles away in Piccadilly, Claire and Crooks are fighting their way through the morning traffic.
This is a bit outrageous, rush hour, because this becomes gridlocked and you just cannot move at all. Every direction that's around, it's just gridlocked, you cannot move.
There's a yellow box junction right in the middle of Piccadilly Circus there, yeah? Now, nobody's not supposed to enter that unless the other side is clear. Now, it obviously ain't clear.
It takes hours to clear, just hours.
Okay, look, there you go. Bang in the middle of the friggin' road. No one can't go nowhere now. Look at all those pricks over there, all in the yellow box junction, you understand what I mean?
As usual, the morning rush hour has played havoc with the bus schedule. Back at Hammersmith bus station, the service controllers for London United buses are picking up the pieces. Sandy Pole is one of them.
Hello. Thank God for that, it's chaos. Yep. All right then. Yeah, it's just busy.
Working with Sandy is Jim Domican, a busman of many years' experience.
Kim, you got any spare OPO drivers? No one at all.
So mainly my responsibility is the 209, the 609, the R69, the 283, the 27, and I'm what they call an agent for any other London United services that come into the bus station, which is like the routes out of our garages. This book tells me how it should be. This book tells me when all the buses on the routes are due through.
It might surprise bus users to know that all London buses run to a strict timetable. It's Sandy and Jim's impossible job to keep them running according to the book.
Everything from what I can gather at the moment is being held up. We've got problems on the 9s, the 27s are running late. 209s aren't doing too bad. Richmond, I would imagine, is bad. Until I start getting some of the buses back and get to speak to some of the drivers, then I don't really know where the hold-ups are.
What's causing the problems?
Traffic.
If buses can't be relied upon, there's little choice but to take the car, adding to the traffic. Caroline Davis is now reluctantly on her second school run.
But it's down to two schools now, which is a big help. It was three schools at one stage. And this is the bus stop where we were catching the 72 every morning, which was very easy. Just walk them up there, make sure they got on the bus safely, and you know, we'd be back in the house by 8:15. But with it being unreliable, we're now having to run them down too.
In the morning peak in West London, one in four private cars is on the school run.
When I was at school 30 years ago, I lived about 10 minutes walk away, and so did many of the people I was at school with. Nowadays, children travel more than five times the distance that they used to travel 15 or 20 years ago. That's putting a lot more traffic on the road, and in the morning peak, it's putting traffic on the road at a very critical time because the journey to school time is the same as the journey to work time.
But you notice the difference when the kids are off. There ain't so much traffic on the road and all that. All the mums taking their kids to school and everything. It's a lot more freer all day, and it just flows a lot more better. But when kids are on, it's just really awkward. But then everyone wants their own little home comforts, don't they? Look, everyone wants to be in a car nowadays.
But the days of everyone having their own car are numbered. Today, Hammersmith is being dug up again. But look at the contrast with 40 years ago, when the roads were last reshaped. In those days, the car was king.
Subways were constructed beneath the roads to segregate pedestrians from ground-level traffic.
Today, the opposite is happening. The subways have been replaced by pedestrian crossings, and roads, instead of being widened, are now being narrowed.
But Hammersmith is terrible, isn't it? Look. And look, I've just cut it all off. I mean, they've just blocked the road for I don't know what. I mean, now, to get round there, I could have just cut down there. But now I've got to go all the way round the roundabout again. That didn't cause no problems to anyone, really. I don't know why they've cut that off. Serious, innit? I'd like to know why. I'd like to meet the people who cut half of these roads off, because I bet they don't even drive. They just sit in their office and think, yeah, we'll cut this road off here.
The man responsible is Roger Carner, and he's unrepentant.
This road's been like this for about 50 years. We're taking every bit of space we can out of the carriageway to give it to pedestrians. We really are bringing it down to the minimum to allow two buses to go along the road. We're taking up to about 6 feet out of the carriageway.
I don't know who he is exactly. I know he's a council worker that doesn't really give a shit. He either doesn't give a shit or he doesn't know what he's doing. Yeah, he's making traffic worse.
But making traffic worse is not something that worries Roger. He's a man with a mission.
This is the town centre. It's bisected by a very busy main road. The priority's been to keeping traffic moving at any cost. We change that balance.
These roadworks in Hammersmith typify a new approach that'll make life harder for car drivers and easier for pedestrians and buses. Traffic engineers have replaced the carcature with a new ideology, the carrot and stick.
If you're really going to try and encourage people to switch from cars to bus or any other form of public transport, you've really got to use a carrot and stick approach.
Making the public transport more attractive is the carrot, but eventually you will need a stick.
It's what level of stick is going to be used to persuade the driver to leave his car at home and move over to public transport.
Some emphasise policies like parking restraint and road pricing that'll make driving less attractive and more expensive. They're the stick men, like Roger.
There are no carrots. There are no foreseeable carrots. We've 5 years of stick. That stick is going to have to be wielded with quite some vigour. And it's going to be very, very unpopular.
Others look to a future of modern and reliable buses. They're the carrot men.
In terms of the carrot, that is making improvements to bus services, making the bus easier to use, making it more attractive to use.
So what carrots can be offered to people waiting in bus queues? It's annoying not knowing when the bus is going to arrive. Giving passengers that information would be a major carrot, which is the idea behind the countdown system.
Information that's on here is past the bus stops. A bus will show 20 minutes late here, will show in a bus stop. The next bus is 20 minutes late.
Countdown is part of a wider project to keep passengers informed and controllers in control.
The controller can take decisions about managing the service because, for the first time, the controller actually knows where his or her buses are.
At least that's the theory.
Sierra 262, 262, 220, you're receiving, over. He's trying to get hold of a bus, I can't get hold of him.
You put it on a local garage?
It's not even on
there. You put it on a garage?
Yeah, I've done everything, he won't answer the bugger. Anyone seen Sierra 262 on the 220s? So can you tell him to give me a call, please? Much obliged, out to you.
Who was supposed to get hold of it?
We don't.
There's obviously the old blip in the pipeline.
Blip?
Even more annoying is when you wait for ages and then several arrive at once.
It's obvious what they're thinking. Oh, there's no one looking after these again. They're all over the place. You were staying here for 20 minutes waiting for a bus. 200 turn up at once. It's the same story, but it is true. It does happen. On a 10-minute headway, you're going to have it happening. There's not a lot you can do about it.
Stop buses travelling in groups and you give passengers a welcome carrot. But when buses hit traffic, there's not much a controller can do.
What happens is, like this scenario here, we had a bus caught up coming through the traffic down Scrubs Lane. He's left on time. He's lost 15 minutes.
The bus behind is actually picking up less passengers because the gap between the two buses is less and less people have arrived at the stop. And so it is actually starting to get a little bit ahead of schedule. And you can see as this process goes on down the route, the two buses come together. This is a situation that gets worse the further you get down the route.
If the traffic gets bad, then two is common. Three happens. Four is a nightmare. Five, you're really in trouble.
In other words, as long as buses have to compete with traffic, they'll end up bunched together.
Buses have to compete. That competition is a conflict. Where conflict takes place, queues exist. Where queues exist, congestion happens.
I'm not waiting. Sorry, mate. Sorry, mate.
So it's a competition for a limited road space.
The fastest growing category of road user is the light goods vehicle, the infamous white van. Epitomizing this predatory creature is Amtrak driver Paul Wright, who's got 50 packages to deliver before lunch.
See, he should be on the road. I'll give way to other couriers, because I know they're in the same predicament as me. They're in the same predicament as me. But other than that, I don't let no one. You don't give way to no one, because I mean, you're on a mission, aren't you? I'm on a mission. Bus lane, what bus lane? I think they should do away with bus lanes anyway. They cause half the traffic anyway. Serious, isn't it?
More white vans is not the only reason why roads are clogged up during the day. We no longer walk to the corner shop, but like Caroline here, we take the Volvo to Tesco's.
Well, I've just come in with, about a dozen bags of shopping from Tesco's, which is our closest big superstore. And not surprisingly, I take the car, as that wouldn't travel back on the bus very easily. And I do that at least once a week. And the second time I might go down there is for the fresh stuff. We no longer, sadly, have a greengrocer at the top of the road. I used to have a very different style of shopping, and sort of shopping a big supermarket shop every couple of weeks and walking up to the greengrocer and walking back with a couple of bags of vegetables and everything. But now that he's closed, which was as a result of Tesco's opening, I go down to Tesco's probably twice a week.
A typical supermarket will receive about 15 deliveries every day from vans and lorries.
Buses now have to compete with the 40-ton Arctic, and it's a very simple equation which goes, we have a wide bus, we have a wide goods vehicle, and we have a narrow road. All of these things don't fit, and because they don't fit, they squeeze past one another.
Every day, this supermarket prompts 1,400 journeys by shoppers, and more problems for Jim as he tries to get his buses back on schedule.
For instance, now a driver's just contacted us now, and he said Halston High Street's almost a standstill. Now, our route runs to Halston. What you have to do, well, you have to put most of your service short of Halston, or you're not going to get them back. So that's another headache. Now we've got to turn buses short of Halston. And it's mainly due to too many cars in one place at one time. And half of them are just leaving him there and shooting off and doing whatever they've got to do.
London's road system is very old, very, very old. Many of our streets are based on Roman and medieval street patterns designed for the horse and cart.
I don't know who designed the roads. The roads are really old, though, aren't they? I mean, they were built in Roman times and everything, when they had, like, coaches and horses and everything. They're not designed for all this traffic and, like, the bigness of the vehicles and everything. So you've got no choice. You've got to adapt to what you've got and make the best of it.
You're serious, isn't it?
Idiots like that. You stopped to... I had to cut... Look, look. What are you stopping in the middle of the road for? You're a...
The obvious solution is to separate buses from other traffic by putting in bus lanes, a carrot for the bus user and a stick to beat white van drivers.
We're talking about taking road space away from the car, recognising that there are 50 people on a bus and only 1.5 people on average in a car.
Bus lanes are nothing new. We started putting these in the GLC back in the early 70s.
But 25 years after bus lanes were introduced, they cover only 80 of London's 4,000 miles of bus route.
Every scheme we put in the 70s was fought tooth and nail by every political administration representing local interests.
We could put bus lanes along all bus routes, and what you would do would you'd not get many people on the buses because you would destroy all the shopping down those roads. But there is a limit to what you can do.
Within that limit, London Transport are gradually introducing a bus priority network that will emphasise bus lanes. But why not just get more people off the roads and onto the underground?
The underground system at the moment is heavily congested. At peak times, it can't cope with the demand. If we tried to transfer any significant number of people out of motor cars onto some very heavily congested inner London underground systems, they just couldn't cope.
So why not improve and expand the tube?
It's very difficult to see how you're going to increase the capacity on the tube in the short term. It's not a simple business of just increasing the number of trains on the tube. You've got to look at all the interchanges, and that's an extremely expensive job.
Decades of underinvestment have left the tube with a huge backlog of repairs. The government's struggling to raise private funding to rebuild the system. Even if it succeeds, it's going to take a long time.
Minimum start to finish, 7 years, possibly 12. So they've got to go some other way, and that means using the surface.
This is why the government sees the bus as the saviour of public transport in the capital. It's the cheapest and quickest option.
Why I'm so enthusiastic about the bus being the way forward in solving London's transport problems is it's flexible. You can put on additional buses, you can put on additional routes.
But all these new buses will still have to fight their way through London's traffic. Tonight, bus lanes leading to Hammersmith are blocked, which means gaps in her schedule for Sandy and another long, cold wait for passengers.
It gets a bit sticky, doesn't it? Yeah. But it's things like this that don't help. I mean, I know everyone's got their job to do, but man at park there, he's on the bus lane.
The evening rush hour is beginning and the roads through West London are filling up. Into this looming gridlock comes a legion of mums. It's the school run again. Caroline is collecting her son Toby and Toby's friend Edward.
Which way do you want to go?
Where we went the other night. We wanted to cut around the back of the Munster Road rather than going up the Fulham Palace Road to the top.
It's probably a longer route, but you don't have so much traffic.
Thousands of cars are trying to get through Hammersmith. The traffic light control centre is working well, but the roads are at capacity. A few minor hold-ups and everything comes to a halt, trapping cars and buses alike.
Traffic does run very much at capacity, particularly on a number of central London roads and the approaches to central London. Therefore, you could best describe it as being on a knife edge.
You look out on the road and you have 1,000 vehicles an hour moving down it. You get a problem.
Yeah, Oscar from Bravo 8. If we can get Foxtrot 1-3, please, we can get this lady towed to a better position. She's waiting for...
On Hammersmith Broadway, the police have closed all three lanes to remove a broken-down van.
And 1,000 vehicles an hour stops, and this queue builds backwards faster and faster and faster.
If Hammersmith goes, everything goes. You've had it, because all the surrounding roads lead to Hammersmith.
So one moment we had thousands and thousands of vehicles going through the gyratory, and the next minute you could have a picnic.
As the Broadway seizes up, drivers can't resist squeezing into bus lanes.
Here, I'm down at the bus lane, right, and it's the same usual story. They're all in the bus lane, but what they're... Yeah, I mean, it's going to give you a delay of about... roughly about 10 minutes-ish. This is ridiculous. They just come down here in drones. They know it's not policed. Yeah, and you've got a coach driver annoyed now because he can't get to his time. You know, this is the sort of carry-on. It ruins it for everyone. Because of this scenario, they're coming in 20 minutes, 25 minutes late.
Enforcement has to be improved. There's no question about that. And a lot of work's going on at the moment, particularly with camera technology, both on buses and on the street.
Where are you?
Church,
what? Sorry, say again?
Church Street.
Church Street? Bloody hell.
I find it's easier to turn just towards the Tate's house off the main road.
Well, down their own road there?
Yeah, there's a slightly quicker route that I usually take.
Oh!
You're in the bus lane.
Oh, that's okay.
The evening rush isn't just about traffic heading home. Lynn and Lou are driving into town for an evening out, adding yet more traffic.
Do we have any cars on the road? Should all take buses.
They're driving up from Surrey to a show at the Hammersmith Apollo. The journey would have cost them £24 by public transport. By car, it's less than 10.
No idea what's wrong with him. He can't get through on the radio. We just know he's there with his backup.
Are we okay for time?
Yeah. As long as we find it okay.
Fine. Hammersmith Bridge closed. You're joking. Oh my God. Diversion via Cheswick Bridge. That's what we want. Diversion.
It's estimated that one in 15 cars on London's roads is lost.
Chiswick, can you find Chiswick on there?
Yeah, if you want to get a bus to Fulham Broadway and make a connection from there, it might be better.
OK.
Hasn't been a 211 for an hour.
You know the main road?
Yes, but do you think we can get as far up as them without it backing up?
Normally it's OK.
No, we might give it a go.
Hang on, we got an RTA at Shepherd's Bush Green with...
Cars on the pavement, Shepherd's Bush Road.
Cars up on the pavement, Shepherd's Bush Road.
An accident half a mile away in Shepherd's Bush is disrupting Sandy's buses.
213, due here at 18, Church Street, Kensington.
Chelsea, Vauxhall, Lamb, and I've got all the bloody bridges, but I can't find Chiswick.
When we get to the top here, it's easier to get to my house if you take a right before you go onto the main road.
Can you go right, isn't it? Oh, at the top.
No, you can only turn left at the top here, but if I turn right and go up the North End Road and then I can get up around the back of Blythe Road.
Which way do you want me to go? Straight?
Oh, no, I don't know. I want to go.
Do you want me to keep whizzing around the roundabout?
I don't know. Where do we want to go? I think you'll have to go right.
Being forced to wait an hour just to go to...
Well, no, nobody's forcing you. What I've said to you is get on a bus show in Hammersmith and make a connection here.
But I have to pay two tickets.
Well, you get a bus pass then.
So
turn around and go back.
Because next time...
I think
we are doing the train.
No, next time I'm going to drive and you...
Oh, navigate, yes, that'll work a lot better.
And, I mean, we can't get through the traffic any quicker than traffic. We just haven't got the resources. There's no public transporting company in London, I don't think, that's got the resources to provide a really good service for the public. It doesn't matter how hard we try, we are never, ever going to provide them with a good enough service to warrant leaving their cars at home until there's some major changes.
The average car commuting to London contains 1.1 passengers. Only 13% of commuters drive, but their impact is enormous. The traffic engineers have a new strategy to stop them.
If you can't park your car at the end of your journey, then you're less likely to use it. You'll think twice about it.
Parking restraint is a big stick, and no one uses it more enthusiastically than Roger.
Yes, we can see we're underneath Hammersmith Flyover here, and there's a big open area of land that for many years has been an open car park, an open space. This year, we'll be removing the whole of this car park, and we'll be building a new public park on its land, so something like 200 cars will be removed from the parking spaces in the centre of Hammersmith. I don't think anything like this would ever be welcomed by a car driver. You know, I used to have a place to park and I've not got one. We've removed something like 30,000 spaces from the streets of Hammersmith and Fulham, of places where people could commute in by car. And no, none of them are happy about it.
Enforcement of parking restrictions is now in the hands of local authorities, giving them a new stick to beat motorists and clear a path for buses.
It's approximately 8:15 at the moment. What we're going to do this morning is mainly clear the main roads for the heavy traffic that's around in the morning, the bus lanes, and also the other bus routes that are causing obstructions for the local buses and for the local traffic going through.
You can't talk to Hammersmith traffic wardens like I can like with West Kent and everything, because they ain't listening, because they've heard it all before. And whether you're doing a delivery or not, whether it's heavy or small or not, they're just going to give you a ticket anyway.
Yeah.
Where am I supposed to park then?
Around one of the side streets.
You're having a laugh. You've got
it. You're right. Thank you. Nice man. I would have let him off until he called me a prick.
Being towed away on the back of one of our tow trucks. I genuinely feel it's a job well done. I don't feel sorry in any way whatsoever. I think they've done something pretty stupid. I don't want to tow them away. I don't want them there in the first place.
The war against parking will soon escalate. The Great London Authority will have powers to tax private parking spaces. This could make driving in town even more expensive, while the income would be invested in public transport. Classic carrot and stick. For Sandy, investment in buses and a reduction in traffic can't come soon enough.
Scary Jean. Where's the hold-up?
They've blocked up Park Paddington. Although you can turn your left on Edgware Road, they've blocked that off as well.
Oh, right. What's Hammersmith Road like?
It's getting nasty.
Getting nasty. OK, darling. See you later, hun.
Is it Hammersmith Road?
Hammersmith Road's getting sticky, and apparently they've closed off part of Paddington.
When you get a little traffic build-up in the West End, all you can see is red. You know, nothing but buses.
The traffic build-up in the West End is having a knock-on effect further out, so some drivers start looking for rat runs.
There's police over there, but I've got to do it. No more.
The rat run is a battlefield. Once upon a time, the engineers helped traffic flow at all costs. Not anymore.
We're in a residential area just off the gyratory system. And what we're doing here is a traffic calming exercise, which is basically trying to deal with motorists who found a rat run round the back. It's a very devious one. It's not straightforward, but they found it because as soon as the congestion comes into Hammersmith, they're all looking for a way through. Save time.
It's a little bit like water in a simplistic sense. You try and do some traffic management somewhere, and unless you dam every other little road, then it finds its way through.
Wow, see, this rat run I'm doing here now, to cut the lights out, because the lights have just changed now. So so I've got to... This just cuts out a lot of the traffic, like waiting to turn right at the traffic lights.
We're breaking out the edge of a curb, we're narrowing down the road, and we're putting in here what are called speed cushions.
See, it's terrible round here. This is a rat run here. But as you can see, it doesn't turn into a rat run anymore because it's just, like, congested, isn't it? Look, because everyone's using it.
The rat run is still alive and well and with us. And the moment you blink or turn your head, you find that they found another one.
No entry. I've got to do it. Sorry. Serious, isn't it? I've got to do it.
Traffic calming is just another stick. The carrot remains better services. Privatisation of London's buses started in 1985. They're still closely regulated, but government subsidy has fallen by 90%. Many bus operators are struggling to find enough staff to maintain services.
This job is so easy to come by now. You know, people walk in and just walk out of this job like nobody's business now. Before, it was airtight. You couldn't get a job on LRT. You couldn't get a job on LRT. Now they're taking people, you know? They're taking people like nobody's business because half the garages are understaffed, you know what I mean? They're losing mileage all day because they ain't got staff and blah, blah, blah. No one don't want the job no more because it ain't paying, you know?
Now bus companies are finding themselves short and they're having to take on people they may necessarily not have taken on before.
Yeah, what was I saying? Yeah, £160 a week is what some guys take home. Sometimes they're lucky to take that home, yeah? 1 week you might have your phone bill, next week you're gonna have your gas bill, week after that they want council tax, you know what I mean? I mean, that money wouldn't be so bad if I was living in Jamaica, you know what I mean? You know what I mean?
They're wizards, they're used to shooting around, darting about, don't give a monkeys half of them.
If you pay peanuts, you get monkeys, don't you? You know what I mean? And what do monkeys do? They're into monkey business. You understand?
For some crews, monkey business means deliberately bunching buses together. It's called scratching.
Scratching is a fact of life.
It happens.
It happens. I mean, you know, no matter what garage you go to, you know, you'd always find a bus behind another bus.
Scratch is in progress. Taking all my passage, mate. He's doing all the work. Sitting right behind him, staring at him and laughing at him. Yeah, boy, it's all about the bus in front, mate. Which means I can sit down now, pick up my newspaper. I've only got the sun. I read some bullshit for the rest of the day now. Some tabloid stuff. I would have liked for someone to left me the old Financial Times or, you know, the Times, so I could have read that, you know? You're gonna have some real news. I am number one scratcher. I am the king. You know what I mean? You leave out on my time and I don't go round you. It's as simple as that. I will do that every round, every day of the week. I will take my money home and I'll think to myself, all in a day's good work.
Sandy's got a 220 ready to leave, but no driver. The only solution is to take one from another bus and sort out the consequences later.
I know it's early. I'll give you a docket. Have you got any dockets on you? I'll
get it sorted out later.
All right, we'll sort it out on your meal relief.
Staff shortages cause gaps in service. There's not a lot you can do about that. That's down to staff. We just had a few there just a minute ago, just blew out, not bothering coming in.
Is that due to sickness?
Just absent, just don't fancy coming in.
Behind.
And what you're left with is in a scenario like that, you're left with a bus on the road full of people. The driver's finished, so he's getting off, and there's no one to take the bus on.
Which is why Sandy's now transferring the passengers from one number 27 onto another.
You wait for 27?
Yeah.
That one will be going first. If you just wait for the driver. Did you get off this one?
I got off that one. You said take the bus behind.
No, I was talking to the driver, my love, not you. Who got off that one behind? On the back doors, if you got off the one behind.
For the privilege of being shunted from bus to bus, these passengers are paying more for their tickets than in any major European capital. In the last 10 years, prices have risen by a third, although bus companies have cut running costs by 40%.
Let's have a look. All right, then, go on. That's looted. Right.
Yeah, they've cut the cost of running the service, but how many people have to wait outside and catch pneumonia before they get on the bus? If they can get on the bus.
It's Friday evening. Every hour, 180 buses squeeze round the Broadway carrying 6,000 passengers, the same number that are travelling in the 5,000 cars that clog up the system. Caroline will be in one of those cars, making a journey that would, of course, be impossible by bus.
What have we got to tea?
Please.
Well, it's going to be a bit chaotic. Are you going to have it in the car again?
Oh, but I'm absolutely starved.
Well, we've got jacket potato and beans, so what we'll do, and ham, which is
always
popular with you. So what we'll do is we'll drop Nick, we'll leap inside, whiz it through the microwave to heat it up, and you can have it on your lap going around to collect Toby.
The government speaks of attracting new passengers with modern buses. On some routes, they are being introduced. But 14 years after privatisation, controllers like Sandy and Jim are heroically struggling with an ageing fleet.
Tell him to take his foot off the brake. Yes.
Yeah, side light's gone. But I want that bus on time because the one in front's missing. So I can't afford to lose that bus. Well, I could tell you before you leave.
Not until I've got this undone.
You're going the wrong way.
Well, you do it. Man, DIY, stuff like that.
And what
Where's
have
the
you?
Pole? You got the bulb, darling?
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you.
There was a time when you couldn't do this. You'd had the union crawling all over you. But now it's acceptable that they know we need the buses to run, so they allow us to do these sort of tricks. We'll take a bulb off a dead bus, put it on a good bus. It means bums on seats, people getting home.
OK, then, let's hit the road. I've set the milometer because I'm very interested on this timing tonight because I have a horrid feeling the traffic is going to be bad.
I bet it's going to be about 30
And we're only going about 6 miles. Do we risk going down to Hammersmith?
No!
I think all of West London traffic is going to be bad. I think it doesn't matter which way we go tonight.
That's looking very positively.
Claire left Hammersmith half an hour ago, and so far she's running on schedule.
People, man, just want to run them over. It's driving mad. They'll see you coming down the road, you know, bright red, and then they'll spout in front of you. We are now going to be late for Toby.
We're going to be late, we're going to be late.
He's going to be fed up with being abandoned.
Yeah!
It's now taken us half an hour to do 2.9 miles.
Everybody's gonna be late. Everybody's gonna be
late. Oh, not so f***ing stupid! She hasn't even noticed. She hasn't even f***ing noticed. Oh, there you go. Typical. Now, because of accident, I've got to fill out a f***ing accident report. What the f*** are you doing? I'm sorry we're so late. The traffic's horrendous, love. Are you all right?
I had a whole jack of potato.
Right.
You didn't. And I'm going to have a lettuce sandwich when I get back.
You won't be very happy, but we have to go and collect Imogen before 6. We'll be in the car for an hour and 8 minutes, and we've done 13 miles precisely. There's me! 8 foot wide, 14 foot 6 tall, 5 red! Sir, excuse me! What? Hold on! Not being funny, there's no excuse. Big red bus, she didn't see it. Yeah, love. You're tripping the handbrake on! Will you take the handbrake off? Jesus Christ! She didn't put the handbrake on, man, there's a kid in the car!
How long should it take to get home?
Well, I don't know. We're not doing very well.
I'm so hungry,
well,
Mummy.
Guy, you've had something
You've
to
had
eat.
Something hot.
Yeah, but...
Guy, I'm sorry, but we're stuck in very unhelpful traffic. Yes, this is 0311. I've just had a car pull up in front of me, and I've taken off a rear bumper. She wants the police down here. I'm at the Aldwych, over. Right, we're nearly there. There's not the issue, I'm just saved your kid's life. I have just saved your kid's life.
The issue is...
I was so frightened and I had to go to police. I was so frightened, excuse me, I was so frightened. Keep her away from me because the mood I'm in now, I'm
I will drive my bus right over a poxy car.
Imogen, just be patient.
Don't, Toby!
Imogen?
Ow!
Oh, Imogen, come on, be a bit patient, because if we hadn't let you go out to tea, you'd have had to drive all the way around too. As it is, we've come round to collect you, OK? Just remember that when you're feeling grumpy, Bobbit.
It's fine, Dale, thanks. Gonna have another one now. And cheers! Bye! See, if you're nice to the police, they're nice to you.
Oh, man, it's just a day in the life of a bus driver, really, isn't it?
Neither Claire nor the car driver were prosecuted as a result of their crash.
Are you optimistic about the future of buses?
We can't afford not to be. It's very difficult to see if we can't persuade people out of the cars onto buses in the short term where we're going to go. You can't just say we're going to stop people coming in, that's it. We have to give them that alternative, and we've got to make the bus a really good, viable alternative that's comfortable, reliable, frequent and cheap.
Is that possible?
Yes.
You said confidence?
Yes. Because it has to happen. And if it has to happen, it will happen.
It is not going to be easy. It is not a painless path that we're going to have to go down.
Above all, there'll have to be a change in the status of the bus.
Bus users seen as a second-class citizen, people with no alternative, the captive passenger. It's an uncomfortable trip. It often isn't a clean trip. Given a choice between the cold and uncomfortableness of waiting for the vehicle, of not knowing when it's going to come, and the surety of getting into a motor car. I mean, quite frankly, given a choice, who'd choose a bus?
Here we are. Okay. Home, James. We've even got a new love ladder chap, so that's
James,
some excitement.
Where go the horses?
Yeah, the horses can go back in the stable.
Oh. Right, better late than never.
I'm really fed up now.
Had enough. I want to go home.
I've got another 2 hours and 25 minutes.
The Red London bus remains stuck in traffic. Clearing a path for it means reducing our freedom to drive, which most of us take for granted.
Jim, how do you travel to work?
I actually drive a short distance, I may add.
No excuse.
There is no excuse. I merely do it for comfort and convenience.
Does Sandy take the bus?
If I had a reasonable journey to work by public transport, apart from my dead earlies and very late shifts, I would probably use public transport. I'm quite happy to sit on a bus and let somebody else take the strain. Read a book, doesn't bother me. Because it's such an awkward journey. For me, it's three buses and a train.
I could quite happily get a bus in, not a problem.
But you don't?
I don't.
Why?
I don't want to.
See, that's the kind of attitude.
Next week, the joys of the open road. Well, that was the original intention of the motorway system. That's here on BBC Two at 8. Next tonight, several careful owners reminisce about old frog eyes.
Goes to James Worthington.
Heart starts Wednesday at 9:30 on BBC One.